Welcome. This is Unit 17 in the Expert Track. In this unit, we present economic tools for ecosystem-based disaster risk reduction and introduce methods of cost-benefit analysis and ecosystem valuation that are specific to Eco-DRR and EBA. Here are our learning questions for this session. First, what economic tools are used for decision-making on disaster risk reduction and climate change adaptation? Second, how can we apply cost-benefit analysis to Eco-DRR and EBA? Third, what are the payments for ecosystem services and how can they be applied to Eco-DRR and EBA? Decision-making on disaster risk reduction takes place at various scales, from the national down to the local level. At the macro level, governments take decisions, while at the local level, stakeholders such as communities and project managers are involved. Yet, the economic principle behind rational decision-making is the same. We either want to obtain the best protection against hazard events with a given amount of investment and cost over a certain period of time, or we try to identify the least costly instruments to achieve a certain given protection level. Especially in developing countries, financial resources are scarce and the budget available for disaster risk reduction and adaptation must be subdivided in technical, ecological and socio-economic measures. How can we make sure to get the best protection with limited resources? Decisions on how to reduce disaster risk are often made based on a variety of economic tools. How can we apply cost-benefit analysis to Eco-DRR and EBA? Cost-benefit analysis is one of the most common decision-making tools. We will introduce it here with an example from Fiji. A recent study carried out cost-benefit analysis to assess climate change adaptation options for the city of Lamy in Fiji. The study compared green solutions, such as planting mangroves and stream buffers, with grey investments such as engineering structures, for example, seawalls and increased drainage. The study concluded that ecosystem-based measures yielded a 19.5 Fijian dollar benefit to cost ratio, as compared to grey investment estimated at 9 Fijian dollars. Nonetheless, the study also revealed that in terms of avoided flood cost, grey investment provides 25-50% damage avoidance, while ecosystem-based options generally provide 10-25% in avoided damages. The study suggests that a hybrid solution between green and grey infrastructure may be the best option for the city's coastal defense and adaptation strategy. What can be learned from this study? First, avoided cost for reducing disaster risks is a commonly used method for assessing the value of ecosystem. Second, another common method is a replacement cost, which refers to the cost that would be incurred if a valuable ecosystem, such as a coral reef, would have to be replaced by an engineered structure. So, considering the case of Lamy, the replacement cost would include the cost to build a seawall and most likely also frequent beach replenishment. Third, unfortunately, many governments do not consider investments in ecosystems or green infrastructure as part of the range of possible disaster risk reduction measures. However, cost-benefit analyses have shown that green investments can be cost-effective in the long run because benefits continue to increase, while grey investments require renewal or high maintenance costs. Additionally, ecosystem-based measures have many other benefits which technical measures cannot offer. As discussed in Unit 16, it is possible and often necessary to combine grey and green infrastructure to optimize protection as long as civil engineering structures do not create unsustainable ecological harm. Finally, many other ecosystem services, such as water filtration, tourism, or aesthetics, are more difficult to quantify in terms of monetary values. Therefore, we observe that valuing ecosystems as part of cost-benefit analysis is limited as such economic tools do not take into account the total value of ecosystems. Payments for Ecosystem Services, or PES, is an incentive-based mechanism that utilizes financial transactions between providers and beneficiaries of ecosystem services. The basic idea is that landowners and farmers receive payments to manage their land properly and avoid costs that are related to unsustainable land use, such as water contamination. How does PES relate to disaster risk reduction and climate change adaptation? These issues are usually not directly addressed in PES schemes. However, measures such as reforestation and forest management that aim at carbon sequestration, watershed protection, and biodiversity conservation often also contribute to disaster risk reduction and climate change adaptation. For instance, by reducing the risk of floods, droughts, and landslides. Among the few examples where disaster risk reduction is directly addressed by a PES are forest protection schemes in Switzerland, where the national government pays landowners to carefully manage protection forests that prevent avalanches, landslides, and rockfalls. Most PES schemes are initiated and funded by governments and often involve non-governmental organizations. But there are also several examples where the private sector is involved. This is, for example, the case where a private water supplier pays upstream users not to use pesticides. In conclusion, we should say that, first, ecosystems need to be considered as an integral part of disaster risk reduction. And second, there is much more that can be done to further develop both cost-benefit analysis and PES schemes for decision-making for Eco-DRR and EBA. One of the main challenges is how to value many of the indirect benefits that we get from ecosystems, such as biodiversity.